You know, eventually you just kind of stop tasting these. That's when you start thinking weird sci-fi stuff. Is that Asimov? Is that you? Now, I've never made one myself, but rumor has it there's a lot of things you have to take into account when designing a game. Obviously, there's the gameplay itself, and the aesthetic. That's what grabs a consumer's eyes. But pop the hood, and now we're looking at the hardware, we're looking at the software. What kind of engine you got here? What kind of code you running? Are you making your own? What are the strengths? What are the limitations? And somewhere else, on a nice island, there's someone sleeping on a pile of money, dreaming about monetization. I won't bore you with the details. I mean, basically, you take the number of yachts you want to buy and divide by 100. Don't forget to adjust for tax. But keep in mind, video games are a relatively younger entertainment medium. We haven't exactly figured out how to balance money, gameplay, and hardware yet. After years and years, we now have definitive proof that there's diminishing returns when chasing after next-gen graphics. The pixels can only get so pretty. And having extra polygons ain't drastically changing how I feel about Madden NFL games. On the money side of things, I will always advocate for the welfare of the consumer. So while not overtly shady, I personally believe the gaming industry needs to stop with all the psychological coyness. Don't flirt with me. Name your price and be done with it. To complicate matters even further, video game immortality has entered the room, and we need to talk about this elephant in particular before the inevitable stampede. Video game longevity depends on three things: active development, active player base, and modern relevance. Modern relevance is the most obvious because popular games are played, shocker. It's also the most volatile factor, as relevancy can come and go at the drop of a hat. Games rise, they fall, and they rise again like the changing tide, with little rhyme, reason, or means to engineer success. In this day and age, the only assured way to make sure a game stays dead is by making it unavailable to the public. Isn't that right, Konami? I know you want to pretend PT never existed. So as long as the bones are publicly available, nerds can gather around to form an active player base. But not everyone's as brave to try things. Some will settle for a faint pulse, but others take more convincing. More promises are required before they settle down. And for them, active development is the only sign of life they will settle for. Back in my day, there was no need for these kind of vows. It was everyone's understanding that no game was meant to last. As we assimilated with the internet, our understandings evolved with it. Expansions, DLC, patches. Yeah, I know. These already existed in PC land, but they weren't commonplace on consoles. Even the master race needed physical discs to continuously update their favorite games. Developers made their forever vows to fans with their franchises. They couldn't promise that our favorite game would last forever, but they promised us future generations. The bloodline will continue. Yet some developers had the forethought or the good fortune to develop their games on hardware that could be upgraded as time went on. League of Legends, Minecraft, and RuneScape are over 14 human years old. To put it into perspective, that's almost 3 Wii U lifespans. And they still consistently dominate content creator pop culture. Rising and falling. Admittedly, the video game elders are predominantly multiplayer functions, but immortality can be bestowed to single-player games as well. Dwarf Fortress is proof of that, and Todd Howard's got some weird cloning obsession going on with Skyrim. Let go, Todd, just let go. It's been over 10 years of this. With all that in mind, the games industry has to make a choice. Design for now, or design for forever. On one hand, I applaud Nintendo's stoicism in the face of the inevitable. They're putting their foot down. New consoles, new games. The promise they choose to make is pedigree. You want to play the old games, eh? Buy the old consoles. You want to play the new games? Well, buy the new consoles. They never put anything on sale, so I don't like it, but I do respect it as a consumer. I know where I stand, I know where Nintendo stands, and it makes it harder for them to get sneaky grabs in my wallet. On the other end of the spectrum, I do like some games that bit the bullet early on. I hold nothing against developers who set out to just make a game. They see a potential future, so they upgrade the hardware for active development. You got your Dota 2s, you got your CSGOs, and I don't play either. These games have always been what they've always been. Once again, I may not like it, but I do respect it. But there's two kinds of games that I wag my finger at. I don't respect these at all. Firstly, you got the games that are created from the beginning with the sole purpose of immortality. They have no vision and hardly any flavor. And secondly, you got the games that aren't built to last, but they pose the promise as if they do. The only thing either of these game archetypes thought through was they wanted it to last forever. And by it, I mean the money flow. They got your battle passes, your dailies, your weeklies, your seasons, your converted currencies that take forever to grind out. These games are filled to the brim with things to do beyond just what the game offers, because it really doesn't offer that much. Play this game mode this many times, do this interaction this many times, and then come back tomorrow, same time, do it again. I only need one reason to play a game. I enjoy playing the game. These games are becoming so needy, regardless of studio budget. Blizzard launched Overwatch with a full-blown esports scene on day one. Then they re-release virtually the same game, but with a more aggressive reach for your time and wallet this time around. Call of Duty, trying to cash in on the Battle Royale trend, releases their own free-to-play model alongside their regular titles. Halo may be improving with time, but what a sad state of affairs Infinite began with. AAA studios are selling me IOUs. And as much as I would love to blame the higher-ups for taming the smaller, innocent indie darlings, I got an uneasy feeling it was the other way around. At the very least, the indie scene might have found their way into these nasty habits independently through Kickstarters and other crowdsourcing means. Figured out dangling the same carrot over and over can potentially bring in more money than simply selling the carrot outright. But don't let my sparkling negativity fool you into thinking we're past the point of no return. I'm genuinely hopeful for what the future will bring from the video game Immortals. Open modding and active voting from the player base is a great example of keeping track of the community pulse. Games can have a second, third, or fourth chance to improve. My main and most vocal concern is the money-hungry misstep selling empty promises makes it difficult to be a savvy consumer. How can I write a game off as not worth my time, a rushed piece of trash, if it can change eventually? How about on the other end? How are my purchases safe of the games I do enjoy, when they can ship a Theseus themselves into something completely different in later years? No purchase is safe, and in a backwards, upside-down kind of way. Part of my gaming fatigue at times comes from these wannabe forever games that are popping up. There's something freeing about playing a game that sets out to entertain you for a few fleeting moments, and it doesn't matter if it succeeds or fails, it just didn't try to keep me busy for as long as humanly possible. And there's equal joy to be found in the games that do keep trucking along, they keep on being developed, but they don't demand I pay attention to their every promise. Have a little nostalgia for another Terraria run. Oh look, that's new. How nice. And what I'm describing is no different than what mobile games already employ, and the free-to-play market's been going in this direction. None of this is new. It's just becoming more commonplace and creeping into the rest of the game industry as trends tend to do. It's slipping outside of the industry even, into car companies, social media, movies, you name it. Capitalism at its core is meant to create healthy competition by killing off those lacking in quality. But what happens when those lacking in quality have lost the ability and the common decency to crawl into a hole and die? You get these games that won't settle anymore for money. They want your bodies. They want your time. They no longer want to pop into pop culture. They want to be the only culture that's popping. And you can't spell culture without cult. And another U. And an R. And finish off with an E.